Hey everyone, it's Konrad Bobilak here, CEO of Investors Prime Real Estate and best-selling international author of Australian Real Estate Investing Made Simple. Welcome to today's video. Today's video is all about gentrification, which is a term that's been thrown around a lot in real estate. And I can tell you now, most people have no idea what the actual definition of gentrification is, because it is not simply a suburb going up and getting rejuvenated and going up in value. It's more specific than that. Now, there's many suburbs in Melbourne and Sydney and Brisbane that have gone through rejuvenation over the last decade, 2 decades, even 3 decades, but very few suburbs have gone through gentrification. And this is what this video is about. It's about identifying the key fundamentals of gentrification, exactly what it means, how to identify suburbs that have the potential to be gentrified, because not every suburb can be gentrified, and when to get in before the money's made. And that's the key. This whole YouTube channel, guys, is designed to make you money in real estate investing. And so the key with gentrification is you want to get in at the beginning before it even starts, ideally, and that's where the majority of the money is made. Once it becomes gentrified and normalized, the money's made. Once it's in the media, the money's been made. The smart money, the stealth money goes in at the beginning, not at the end. And this is one of the challenges with property investing. We want to be able to identify these opportunities and going at the very beginning where the smart money goes in. And that's what we're going to focus on today. So welcome to today's video. Before we get started, a bit of a personal disclaimer. I've never met you. I don't know your financial situation or financial standing. Therefore, this is purely educational information only. Don't act on anything that I'm giving information on today. Pardon me. And by all means, speak to someone that's qualified, and make sure that if you do speak to someone that's qualified, they have the exact results that you want to achieve. A bit about my background. I'm a real estate agent. I'm an ex-mortgage broker, ex-banking with NAB, Medfin, and also I used to work in funds management with Australian Unity Funds Management in financial planning. But the main thing is, guys, that I'm a property investor, just like yourself, in Melbourne, buying properties, refinancing properties, and my company specializes in helping investors build up large property portfolios. So basically all day I'm talking to developers, valuers, accountants, lawyers, real estate agents. So I know exactly what's happening in the Melbourne property market. I've got my finger on the pulse and I'm sharing this information just openly with you guys so you don't make mistakes and hopefully we'll make some money. Also, I want to thank you guys for supporting me and buying my books. My book on real estate investing made simple has got number one bestseller multiple times on Amazon and various other websites and bookshops. And many times they've been featured in the top 10. I've had both my books, my finance and real estate book in the top 10, which is fantastic. And both of them have hit number one in various categories on Amazon. So I want to thank you guys for buying my book. I'm really grateful for that. It's a very humbling experience when I get those notifications that I've hit number one again in a specific category. If you want to get a copy of my book on finance, which teaches you how to smash your mortgage and build up a large property portfolio passively, jump onto bookonfinance.com.au and you get a bunch of freebies, including a home study video course, and also real estate book on realestatemadesimple.com.au, where you also get a bunch of freebies as well. That's the end of that shameless promotion. Let's get into the education. What is gentrification? Let's get the definition perfectly clarified and let's unpack this topic. Gentrification is the process where there's a suburb and for whatever reason, rich people, this is the key guys, not middle class, not yuppies, rich people have decided to move into the suburb and the poor people are getting displaced. That is gentrification by definition, which means it's not going to happen in virtually every suburb in Melbourne. Most suburbs never experience gentrification, okay? So the first thing is, and I'll talk about specifically which suburbs have the key ingredients that will allow them to gentrify, and which suburbs would simply go through the process of rejuvenation, which is not gentrification. That just simply means there's more money going into the suburb, and the suburb is improving in terms of its demographics and aesthetically. That is not gentrification. So basically, and I'll show you a number of examples, but what we're doing is we're going from this to that. And the key is wealthy people are moving in. So we're getting rid of these people, and we're getting more of these people. That's the key, okay? So it is, and these people get displaced permanently because they can't afford to rent there, they can't afford to buy there. Well, they never buy anyway because they're on Centrelink or supplements. so they can't get qualify for loans. But they get displaced, they get and completely out of the area. That is gentrification, guys. Now, what would make that person move into that suburb? That's the key thing. Because remember, wealthy people can live anywhere they like. So why would they move into a suburb? Okay, and this is the key misinterpretation where people confuse gentrification with rejuvenation. So I'm going to talk about that today, and I'll give you my number one suburb and number two suburb for gentrification in Melbourne right now that is off the radar and it's heating up without no one's really talking about it, which is incredible. So let's get very specific with the definition of gentrification. Gentrification is the process of changing the character of a neighborhood through the influx of more affluent residents and businesses. It is a common and controversial topic in urban politics and planning. Gentrification often increases the economic value of the neighborhood. So the neighborhood goes up in value, it means capital growth, rental yields, but the resulting demographic displacement may itself become a major social issue. Gentrification often sees a shift in the neighborhood's racial or ethnic composition and average household income as houses and businesses become more expensive and resources that had not been previously accessible are extended and improved. So obviously we're here to make money. I'm not here to talk about social issues, public housing. I don't really care. I never have. Okay. We're here purely just how do I identify these opportunities before they happen and how can you, as a property investor, put your money in before the area ends up on the media and mainstream information. Because by the way, when that happens, there's no more money to be made. I'll give you an example. 20 years ago, I was really bullish on Altona Beach. And 10 years ago, I was sourcing a lot of properties in Altona Beach that was going through the process of gentrification. Wealthy people going in, buying weatherboard properties on the beach with beach views. Now they're worth $2, $3, $4 million, $5 million. Back then, houses were $180,000, $160,000. It was ridiculous prices. I mean, I was selling four bedders in Altona, 10 years ago for $475, brand new builds with double lockup garage. We're talking 180 square meters. So it's crazy. Now, I believe right now, Altona North, Altona Beach, that ship has sailed. I wouldn't even buy anything there because why would you spend $1.1 million in Altona? We can buy the same property in Bentley East. And Bentley East is always going to have double the income of Altona in terms of the average person. Remember, the eastern suburbs is where all the money is in the Bayside. Okay, you can never replicate that in Melbourne because it took 100 years to build up. So the opportunity was where in Altona? It was 10, 15 years ago. Now it's gentrified. It just becomes a normalized suburb. Is it a good suburb? It's okay. It's nothing special. You know, the beaches are average, there's soil contamination, it's on the wrong side of the city for capital growth. But that's not the point. The point is, if you got in 10 years ago, you would have killed it. I mean, people were buying detached houses for $200,000, $300,000, and now they're selling them for 6-7 times more than they paid for. Just check RP data, especially properties where they had dilapidated weatherboard properties. So the area definitely went through gentrification. Another good area went through gentrification is Coburg. I mean, Coburg now, it's crazy what's happening in prices. Imagine the suburb 20 years ago that had a prison inside the suburb, Pentridge Prison. And the surrounding prison were houses that had the girlfriends and the wives of the prisoners who were bringing drugs into the prison system. What a great suburb, right? So I'm 46, when I was 18, 19, Coburg possibly was the worst suburb in Melbourne in terms of income demographics and crime. It was worse than St Albans, Broadmeadows, Frankston North. It was one of the worst suburbs definitely in Melbourne in terms of crime. Now, I mean, it's blue chip. What happened to Pentridge? It got redeveloped into high-end properties. That demographic that was there before got displaced. Obviously, the prisoners went. Coburg Pentridge Prison is heritage protected, so all those blue stones have been retained. There's restaurants there, cafes. A lot of the cells have been turned into wine cellars, which is fantastic. So it's got a real good character there. Properties now in Coburg are selling for $1.2-1.5 million for an average property, up to $2 million for a good home. I remember when Coburg, you couldn't give away a house for $150,000. agents wouldn't even list properties there 20 years ago because of the crime and because of the bad stigma that it had attached to it. And now it's blue chip. So that's a perfect example of gentrification. The problem is, if you're getting at the very end, there's not much money to be made. Because would I source Coburg today? It's not even on my radar, to be honest with you. There's about 100 suburbs in Melbourne that will outperform Coburg in terms of capital growth. So that story has gone. It was good 20 years ago, the ship has sailed. How do I identify the opportunities of tomorrow? This is what this video is all about. Now, what happens obviously to the people that were there before is, now that the neighborhood is nice, why do I have to move? And this is the unfortunate byproduct of gentrification, where that income, the low income demographics is displaced purely because of economic reasons. They can't afford to rent there or buy there. This is government data showing you the areas in Melbourne that are in danger of gentrification. Because remember, from a government's perspective, it's a negative aspect of the reality of what is the property market, because they've got to deal with the fallout, okay? They've got to deal with the social issues. We're not here to talk about that. We're here to make money. We're here as investors. So I don't want to open up Pandora's box on social injustice and how expensive it is to live in Melbourne. It's expensive to live in Melbourne. If you're thinking it's expensive, move to Adelaide. It's just that simple, okay? Don't whinge. No one cares. But this is the suburbs that basically are in risk of gentrification in Melbourne. So you can see that you have Collingwood, Alphington. Now, Alphington has done really well, but the ship has sailed in Alphington. The money's been made 10 years ago. Heidelberg Heights and West, Preston East and West Reservoir, East and West, Faulkner, Coburg, Coburg North, Pascot Vale, Essendon. Then southwest, you've got Footscray, Seddon, West Footscray, Braybrook, Newport, Altona North, Sunshine, Sunshine West, Sunshine North. And you can see that you've got the dark blue patches represent the areas that are highly probable to become gentrified. And then as you go lighter and lighter, you have high probability of non-gentrification. Like, for example, Toorak's not going to get gentrified because it's the wealthiest suburb in Melbourne. So then we got to look at, these are the areas. Now, how do we look at which areas to put our money in to make the most amount of capital growth in the shortest possible period of time? And that's what we're going to talk about. Now, remember, this is fundamental analysis. And I keep talking about, through my videos, the importance of understanding fundamental analysis, not technical analysis. If you do technical analysis on the real estate market, you will die broke. Most academics do technical analysis, they have no properties behind them. Remember, Warren Buffett, the number one investor in the world, does fundamental analysis backed up by technical analysis. So I'm a fundamental researcher, and I back up my information with RP data, CoreLogic, Residex, all the other REIV data. But I don't do technical analysis. I'm not an academic sitting there somewhere in a cubicle at Monash University doing some bullshit research, okay? Because most of them are dead broke. They'll never have any properties. So you just got to listen to people that are actually making money, not theorists. There's theorists everywhere, guys. They end up dead broke on a pension at 65. So one of the most important things is find people that are actually making money out of something and just copy what they do, which is kind of the opposite of the school system, right? So first we've got to look at objectively, what are the top fundamental things that drive capital growth in suburbs? Let's look at them collectively in the context of gentrification, and then let's identify which suburbs out of the ones we previously identified have the greatest chance of fulfilling this criteria, and also from a timing perspective as well, because some of those suburbs have already gone through gentrification, or they're so advanced into the gentrification process, the money's been made already, you know, and it's probably not worth looking at those suburbs. Because remember, there's a risk of going into a gentrification suburb. You can invest in suburbs that are never going through gentrification. They're just upper middle-class suburbs that have done well, okay? Like Hampton, for example, or Sandringham. You know, they're just good, normal suburbs, middle-class suburbs. They've always done well. And you buy a townhouse there or a house, you'll do really well. Nothing needs to happen there. I mean, parts of Sandringham, Housing Commission, that's all been sold off now. There's a couple of sections left. But overall, Sandringham has never been cheap. Mentone has never been a cheap suburb. It's just been a middle-class, good, solid suburb. So remember, there's a risk of going into this investment genre just because it might not eventuate, okay? As investors, what we do is risk and reward. We make educated decisions based on information. So what are the top 10 factors that determine capital growth objectively in Melbourne and Sydney and any suburb? Now, it used to be that really land was valued, or the property was valued, by the distance to the city and the water. And that was very true for Melbourne and Sydney. Because of COVID-19, that basic model has been disrupted to a large extent. And now we have what we call the lifestyle triangle, which is basically the time it takes for a person to travel from home to work, from work, if they have children, to lifestyle strip or school. I mean, if they haven't got children and they're going to school, there's a problem there. And then obviously back home. So for an example, if you're living in, let's say, Roxborough Park, or let's say Pakenham, okay, and you've got to drive to the city every day by car, you're going to take about an hour, probably an hour and a half in peak hour, and then you've got to pick up your kids from school and then go back home, you could be spending 3 hours a day in your car, okay, which means that your quality of life might suffer. But let's say, for example, you're living in Springvale, okay, and you work in Springvale, one of the business parks. So your home's in Springvale, your work is in Springvale, and your children go to Springvale Secondary College. So it takes 10 minutes to get around, so your quality of life is much more enhanced compared to the person that's stuck in the car for 3 hours a day. So people will pay for convenience, and they'll buy the best possible property based on their serviceability. Most people will max out their serviceability and buy the best possible property they can afford to buy with a house. And that is based on their specific priorities at that point in time in their life. If they're a young couple, it could be distance from the city, water, cafes, restaurants. If they're into the schools, it could be in a really good school catchment area. So a lot of people are surprised that most people in Melbourne don't actually work in the city. 75% of people actually work in these red sections, which are business parks around Melbourne. There's only 25% of people that work in the city. And now with COVID-19, a lot of people are working from home and only going to the city 1 or 2 days a week, and sometimes even 1 day a fortnight. My accountant, for example, only goes to Abbotsford once every fortnight for a meeting with the team. My lawyer, for example, who lives in Elsternwick and he works in Albert Park, only goes to the office 2 or 3 times a week, and most of the time works from his home and does Zoom calls all day. So really what happened with COVID, it's changed the game a lot. Now, if you look at these red dots, these are predominantly business parks and also factories and working hubs. On this side of the city, well, the western side predominantly, these are blue-collar parks. So we want to eliminate those because they're more susceptible to volatility based on recession and potentially high interest rates and high inflation. Where these places here, if you look at Kew and all these places here around Heidelberg, Greensboro, these are all hospitals and white-collar business parks, which means you have white-collar professionals, banking, financial services sector, marketing, accounting, and resource sector, and IT. So these are more, I guess, solid during economic volatility. And in fact, a lot of times they're counter-cyclical to the economy. A lot of people, like IT sector is booming right now, same with the medical sector, despite what's happening out there in other industries. So what's happening is that people actually are working in these suburbs, buying a house in these suburbs, and also having their children at school in these suburbs. So the question is, are these suburbs going through gentrification? So where is the highest concentration of workers in Melbourne by suburb? Clayton, number one. And Clayton is a mixture of white-collar, blue-collar, as well as industrial and factories. Tullamarine, which is predominantly the airport, which is all blue-collar. Kew and Hawthorne, predominantly white-collar professionals. Box Hill, St Kilda, and Box Hill, for example, is also going through gentrification, and he's got a massive hospital presence there as well. The medical centre keeps expanding. St Kilda, Moorabbin, Heidelberg, Malvern, Bayswater, Dandenong, Footscray, Glen Waverley, Frankston, Glen Iris, Malvern East, Cheltenham, Hyatt, Ringwood, Wantirna South, Mooney Ponds, La Trobe University, Derry Warren, Burwood East, Oakley, Greensboro, Broadmeadows, Blackburn, Heathmont, Sunshine, Preston, Northland. So these are job hubs or job centres. Most of them are in suburbs except for La Trobe University and Northland, which is obviously a shopping centre and university campus. And this is where you get the highest concentration of people that are working in these suburbs. So if you can have a house, for example, in Wantirna South and send your kids to Wantirna South Secondary College and your job is there, you're going to have a very strong triangle, which means you pay a premium to be there. And these suburbs have a greater propensity to go up in value compared to other suburbs. But the question that arises is, Okay, despite that, despite the fact that COVID-19 had disrupted the market, is the market still governed by the rules of proximity to the city, proximity to water? And the answer is yes. Because remember, COVID's only been around for 3 or 4 years, where really, you know, you look at the last 30, 40 years, that's what's really shaped our property markets in Melbourne and Sydney. So if you look at there for Melbourne and Sydney, for properties that are located between 0 and 5 kilometres from the city, in Melbourne, the median price is 1.56 million. And then as you go further away from the city, 5 to 10 kilometres, the median price drops by 3%, 1.5 million, still fairly good. But the moment you go to 10 to 15 k's from the city, it drops by 19%, median price being 1.2 million. Then 900,000, negative 42%. 843, negative 46. So the further you get from the city, the cheaper it gets. Now remember, it's disproportional because the west and the north are much cheaper than the southeast and the east and the Bayside. I mean, the moment you get to 40 k's or 25 k's west, you're in the middle, you're in Tregennine or Tarmeet, and then there's cow paddocks beyond there. There's nothing there. Or on the other side of the city, you're in the eastern suburbs, you're in prime real estate locations. So you can see that the dark patches represent the most expensive properties by median price in Melbourne, and the orange one's the cheapest. You can see it's disproportionately located in this side of the city. What does that mean? It means that the richest people are choosing to live in these suburbs because they can buy whatever they want. So remember, with gentrification, we're looking for high-income earners that are wanting to go into a suburb that historically was a cheap suburb. So you've got to understand, why would they do that? And what's important to this group of people? These are the questions we've got to answer before we understand where to look. And Sydney's the same. You've got the North Shore and the Eastern suburbs, and that's where all the money is. So the first thing I look for, number one, is historical growth from RP Data CoreLogic. So for example, if you look at Bentley East, just a normal middle-class suburb, nothing special. I mean, it's not Elwood, it's not Port Melbourne, but it's inland, but it's fine. You know, it's not a bad area. Median price 1.36. Growth for 12 months 8.8. For average over 10 years 10.36. So you want to have capital growth of 10.36 for an established suburb. For a gentrification suburb, you want to see clear increase in capital growth gradually creeping up historically as the older houses get demolished and new properties get built. And you can see that Point Cook, for example, which you don't want to invest in because there's about 200 suburbs that will outperform Point Cook. Capital growth for the year, negative 2.33. Annual growth, 4.85 over 10 years, which is below inflation, by the way, if you look at the current inflation data. Historically, Point Cook just performs above inflation because of endless supply of stock. There's nothing wrong with Point Cook in terms of living there. I'm just saying for capital growth, there's an opportunity cost of parking your money there versus an area like Bentley East. Bentley East will always outperform Point Cook, just so you understand. That's my argument. If you live in Point Cook, don't send me an email. I don't care. I never have, okay? So don't send me an email with your story about Point Cook. I don't care. I'll give you 10 other stories that show you how you've lost millions of dollars by having money there. Because I always get people ringing me, oh, we bought a house in Point Cook for $180,000 and it's worth $500,000 today. Whoopie-doo, no one cares, okay? I can give you stories for properties going from $100,000 to $2 million, like in BlackRock and areas like that. So I understand, okay, guys? You got to take the emotion out of the equation. This is purely just to make money. This is not about judging people or making any judgment on social status of people or what they're doing. So then you've got to look at the average household income per capita. You've got to look at where are the most wealthiest people, and this is government data, by the way, so you can check this out from census data, or you can go to www.profile.id.com.au, which is income demographics. So you can see that Cremorne, Richmond, 2,537 per person per week. East Melbourne, 2,285. Port Melbourne, Middle Park, Toorak, Elwood, Albert Park, St Kilda West, Clifton Hill, South Yarra. Guys, if you just build your portfolio out of buying houses and townhouses, not apartments, in these top suburbs, you will outperform 99% of the market out there, just so you understand. Just let me repeat that. If you just buy and build up your entire portfolio without knowing anything more, just focusing on these 10 suburbs in Melbourne, not buying apartments, they don't work, they never will. I'm talking about houses and townhouses that have a land footprint. You outperform 99% of all investors out there. Just so you, like, if you didn't know anything beyond these, that's the best fundamental information you can use. Number three is you've got to have an area that has high demand compared to a shortage of stock. And we look for, this is called DSR ratios, which is demand to supply ratio. So you can see there, you've got a clock there from 0 to 100, and obviously it talks about the demand out of 100 for stock in the area. So for 50-50, there's 50%. So basically, there's 5 buyers for 10 houses, let's say. If you're doing 100 to 100, there's 10 buyers, 10 houses, which means that there's an equal matching principle. So you want to make sure that there isn't a lot of stock coming onto the market in the suburb, which is the problem with house and land estates. There's thousands of blocks that can be released tomorrow by Metricon, Burbank, Simmons, you know, Pete, one of the biggest landholders in Victoria. They've got 25,000 blocks they can release in Point Cook, Trigonina, Tarneit, Roxborough Park, Pakenham and Berwick. Then you've got to look at walk score, the walkability factor, the functioning factor of a suburb in terms of if you were to walk out of your property within walking distance or 5 minutes of your property, how much access would you have to schools, transport and restaurants? So let me ask you, would people pay for the convenience, very difficult question here, of being able to walk out of the property, not drive, walk and access 100 restaurants, 4 of the best private schools in Melbourne, train, tram and bus? Yes, of course they would. So the walk score is an international measure of the walkability factor of a suburb. You can see there, this is a heat map showing you the green patches, which has the highest walk score in Melbourne out of any suburb. So that particular time when that was captured, South Yarra had the highest walk score, nearly 100, which means that 5 minutes walking distance out of any property in South Yarra, you can access over 50 restaurants, tram, train, bus, schools, shops, retail, it's all there. The lowest was Hallam. If you walk out of your house and walk around in 5 minutes, you're just in front of someone else's house. Nowhere near coffee, anything. No restaurants, no cafes. And if you knock on someone's door, you probably get stabbed. So they had the lowest walk score out of all the suburbs in Melbourne. Now, this is an example of walk score analysis for an area, a property that we sold in Bentley, in Vickery Street, number 14 Vickery Street in Bentley. Because remember, within the suburb, and Bentley is a large suburb, there are lower walk scores and higher walk scores within the suburb. Because there are large suburbs, like for example, Doncaster, Park Orchards, Donvale, Eltham. There's sections of Eltham, but there's nothing there, it's just suburbia. So this is not the best measure, it's just one of the measures. But you can see there, for example, that property is located here, just off Centre Road, had a 93 walk score out of 100, which means it's very high. So you can walk to Coles, do your shopping, go back home, get a coffee, go to a 24-hour gym, catch the train to the city, catch a tram to the city, catch the bus to the city, and you've got it within a 3K radius, you've got probably 10 of the best schools in the Bayside area, including tapping into Brighton, Furbank, you know, all those high-end schools, but you're living in Bentley, you're paying a third of the price. So walk score is definitely a very important way to measure. So remember, these rich people that we're targeting that are going to gentrify the suburb, they have to be convinced that the suburb has all these ingredients. It has a very high walk score. So you can't have a low walk score. That's why places like Berwick will never be gentrified, because there is nothing in Berwick. And I'm not talking about old Berwick, I'm talking about new Berwick. It's just suburbia, okay? Nothing's going to happen there. It's just going to do its 5% every year, maybe 6% if you're lucky. Then you've got to target schools, because schools are on the radar, especially with the migrants that are coming into the country. A lot of them are coming here for the children and future generations. So you look at this heat map shows the best, highest ranking private and public schools in Melbourne. You can see, once again, disproportionately, it's in the Bayside, the eastern suburbs. So the chances are, if you're going through an area that's going through gentrification, it has to be somewhere around these heat maps, right? Because this will be one of the factors these people look for, which is higher education. Most wealthy people have education as a high agenda if they've got children. Absolutely, it's one of the priorities. So you can see that this is ranking by TER scores, and you can see once again that disproportionately located in this part of Melbourne. So the clue is, we think we're going to target gentrification suburbs around this area. Okay, I'm making it super simple for you guys. Just here, somewhere here. There are no schools in the west worth mentioning. Okay, none. And it takes 100 years just to, so you understand, to build up the reputation of a school. You can't just build Scotch College, you know, in Trigonino and think it's going to happen. It's not going to happen. So this is government data, by the way, ranking the best schools in Melbourne. So you can see there, just look at the suburbs. Okay, Melbourne High, that's Albert Park. Sorry, that's the city. Macrobs is Albert Park. Forget about those two because they're by invitation scholarship only. So these people are from all around the place. But if you look at just where the schools are located and then you look at the suburbs, it's disproportionately located in the eastern and southeast and Bayside part of Melbourne. Now remember, every suburb has a school catchment area. You know, you can't have a suburb without a school catchment area. So every school, every suburb in Melbourne is in a school catchment area. The question is the school good, number one? Number two, which is a question for us as investors, because I'm not doing a YouTube video about schools. It's about, does the school make a difference in terms of capital growth potential if you buy a property within the school catchment area or outside the catchment area? That's a really good question. So the main difference between the rich and the poor guys is the rich have learned to ask better value questions than the poor. You don't need to become an expert on this. You just need to understand which questions to ask. That's the main difference. So a very good question is, yes, where every area has a school catchment area, there are good schools and bad schools, but how much does that translate into money? That's the key thing. So in Melbourne, for example, the best public school is McKinnon High in McKinnon. And it has the highest TER score out of any public school and the highest transition from that secondary school to medicine and law. Now, recently, McKinnon High has extended its catchment area, and I think they're going to pay the price now. I think that the ranking and prestige will go down now because of the catchment area has now incorporated a lot of people living in apartments. Beforehand, it was pretty much detached houses. So the income per capita has dropped in terms of their profile for their people that are going into the school. And this is the new catchment area for McKinnon Secondary College. It should never extend it grounds, but it had to because it was just, it's pure greed. That's what it is. They could have stayed small and boutique-y and just, you know, kept its prestige name. But no, human nature is not that simple, right? We just want more and more. We have that greed glands secreting all the time. And this is an example of the power of McKinnon High School. This property here in Murrumbina sold for $500,000 above reserve just because it got captured into the new extension of McKinnon High catchment area, which is incredible. So the Murrumbina sellers are on cloud nine after their home sold for $510,000 above reserve amid speculation will be zoned for an in-demand new school. The owners of 12 Wallace Avenue, Murrumbina, set their February 6th auction reserve of $1.87 million. But as 1.7 opening bid made before the auction had finished, their spill quickly escalated to $2.38 million top offer. Half a million just because of the school. So then the question is, what is the difference between in the school catchment area outside and which suburbs have the best schools? So Albert Park College, 1.75 inside the zone, 1.25 outside the zone. There's a difference of 495,000 in Albert Park. Huge difference, half a million. Balmoral Secondary College, 1.68 million versus 1.25 million, $430,000 difference. Whether you buy a property inside or outside the zone. Because remember, this will impact your gentrification. Glenmobie Secondary College, 1.6 versus 1.2, $380,000 difference. Bowen, 2 million versus 1.8, $200,000 difference. Box Hill, 1.4 versus 1.2, $200,000 difference, or $193,000. McKinnon Secondary College, 1.5 versus 1.4, $167,000. I think this will go down over in the future. Mark my words. Perrine High, 1.7 versus 1.5, $147,000 difference. Camberwell, 2.1 versus 2 million, $93,000 difference. East Doncaster Secondary College, 1.3 versus 1.2, $83,000 difference. Yeah, Mount Waverley College, 1.2 million versus 1.2, so $75,000 difference. I mean, 75 is getting really close now, where I think it's becoming irrelevant. Frankston High, I just wouldn't invest in Frankston. It's too far from Melbourne. Nothing's going to happen there. $785,000 versus $720,000, $65,000 difference. Mill Park, 690 versus 62, 38,000, it's nothing, okay? So Mill Park, it doesn't make a difference if you're, I mean, it makes a difference for you because you can send your kids there, but I'm saying for capital growth potential as an investor, if you're buying two houses, one's in the catchment area, one's not in the catchment area, it doesn't really make that much difference. 38,000, that's just a garden or a kitchen remade, you know, that's nothing. Melbourne's Girls College in Richmond, 1.85 is 1.82, 30,000. And Morialic, well, 12,000, that means nothing. So, yes, they do have an impact in some areas, but not all areas. Buy properties in the suburbs, which have the most sought-after shopping strips consisting of trendy cafes. This is the key, guys. You want the suburb to be an older suburb, like Brunswick, which has become a really cool hipster suburb now. And I used to live in Brunswick for a year after I just got married. I loved it because it was just cafes, restaurants everywhere. And this is 25 years ago. Now it's really come up. Old suburb, boring, very ethnic, but cafes and restaurants everywhere, and they're just rejuvenating them. So you want to have that trendy cafes, fashion shops, beautician parlors and gymnasiums in the lifestyle area. This is what yuppies and people with money pay a premium for. Safety is also a big thing. So you want to make sure that they're safe, low crime, but they want to make sure the convenience is there. This is what people want. This is Oakley, for example. Oakley's come up really well as a perfect area that went through gentrification. Oakley used to be rough. There used to be no cafes or restaurants. I remember when I used to live in Chadstone and I used to walk through Oakley to catch the train to go to Christian Brothers College, St Kilda. I would walk through this whole shopping centre and there was only the milk bar with Street Fighter 2 in it. Where you can get you couldn't get a coffee. If you ask for a coffee, they look at you like you're weird, okay? You can get a Coke and a hot dog. And there used to be Ferrari's Pizza and that's it, okay? The rest were just dodgy shops. Now, it's like mini Lygon Street. So as the money moved in and people have discretionary income, what do they want to do? They want to spend it on going out. See, the difference between wealthy people and non-wealthy people is that wealthy people have high disposable discretionary incomes and they want to spend it in their suburb, drinking cappuccinos, sitting around all day, looking at their Ferraris and Porsches parked in front of the cafes, which is BlackRock, Oakley, all these areas, perfect examples, right? Because they've got nothing to do with their time. They just want to sit around on Saturdays, lounge around, you know, in Elwood and meet their friends for a coffee. Because they can do it, and it's cool. We do it. I go there with my wife for dinners. We catch up with friends. We've got a lot of ethnic Greek friends and Italian friends. We love going to Oakley. I'm Polish, my wife's Italian. We love European food. I'm a big fan of Oakley. I think Oakley's done amazingly well. And look at the property prices. I mean, 20 years ago, 150 grand for a house, now 2.5. You know, and I'm talking about Oakley proper, not rezoned Oakley, which is Clayton North. Never buy investment properties in suburbs which have lending restrictions, okay? If there's a lending restriction, guys, forget it, because banks are the most profitable institutions in Australia. If they're telling you not to invest somewhere, don't invest there. So in Melbourne, these postcodes are blacklisted for property investing. So you can only borrow 80%. Melbourne 3000, Melbourne 3004, 3005, World Trade Centre 3006, South Bank, South Yarra, Docklands, South Melbourne. South Yarra and South Melbourne, you can buy townhouses and houses, just don't buy apartments. Apartments are a disaster in those suburbs, okay? So townhouses, no problem. Just put bars on the windows because there's housing commission all over South Yarra. I think people are going to break in. And the bars have to be really close together because those heroin addicts, they're really thin. They squeeze through those little gaps, right? So you got to make them really close together. Buy investment properties in suburbs with the highest level of development and redevelopment restrictions imposed in the area by the council. So this includes suburbs that have high restrictions, height restrictions, density restrictions, heritage overlay, and single dwelling covenants. Port Melbourne, Albert Park, Middle Park, St Kilda West. Can't do anything. Right? There's a joke in the industry. The only way to develop in those suburbs, you've got to burn something down. It's all heritage protected, guys. You know, and this is the thing is, even if you buy that old Victorian or Edwardian, you know, single-fronted property on 150 square metres for $2 million, you can't extend, you can't go up, you can't do anything because everyone will fight you and the council will impose restrictions, which means when something good comes up or where something is rezoned and you have a three-bedroom property, there's so much demand for it by high-income earners, people will pay above premium. And this is why in Port Melbourne and Albert Park, Middle Park, you always see records broken in terms of reserve prices being smashed, because you can't upgrade from Port Melbourne, right? There is no, I mean, Brighton's very different. Brighton, Elwood, Port Melbourne are very specific suburbs. You can't upgrade from anywhere. They've got a very distinctive feel about them. So if you're wealthy and there's a particular property that's come up on the market, it's exactly what you want. There's nothing else that you've seen for 12 months. Of course, you're going to pay, you know, above reserve to get it. But if you're buying a house in Point Cook and there's 400 identical houses every weekend on the market, why would you even pay 10 grand above reserve? It doesn't make sense. So restriction versus non-restriction. Gentrification is the same thing. Now, obviously with gentrification, the whole suburb is getting redeveloped, but then you've got to look at how it's getting redeveloped. What are the restrictions for new builds? And less is more. So with this high density, that's not a good option, because then you're competing with more rentals. Buy investment properties from brand-named award-winning architects with high-level fixtures and fittings that are targeting the 29 to 35 young professional high-income earners. This is your target audience, guys, for gentrification suburbs. Gentrification suburbs are targeted by young professional income earners, 29 to 35, that have the money that can go in there. And Richmond's a perfect example. Richmond, 30 years ago, was quite rough, well-located, and now it's yuppie central, you know? I mean, you just a little tiny weatherboard property on a 150 square meter block, you're looking at $2 million, you know, for two bedrooms virtually, plus study. So a lot of developers that we work with have won awards. This is the Branson Group, for example, which I've done a lot of projects through that I've sourced and sold to my clients. Winner of 2021 HIA Victorian Townhouse Villa Development. Winner 2021 Victorian Townhouse and Villa. So you can see that you want to deal with award-winning institutional builders and developers, not cowboys, not mum and dad developers, because they end up on Current Affairs running from the camera, okay? You don't want to end up on Current Affairs, okay? So, pay, and in life, guys, what I find, like, just like with anything, you get exactly what you pay for. So if you want to get a dodgy builder that works from home, because it's 20% cheaper than these guys, good luck to you. You get the best, you must pay the price. There is no shortcuts. There is no bargains in property, guys. It's just wishful thinking. So this is an example of a project which is architecturally designed in Balaclava, just opposite Yeshiva College, that just settles, literally now it's selling, this month and next month. You can see that the product looks very unique, unlike anything else that's out there. It was designed as a one-off masterpiece. Internally, externally, there's an architect. This is a disaster, and this is the kind of rubbish we're building in Australia, and our fringe suburbs are littered with this crap. I mean, this is, I don't even know where this comes from. This kind of design, people should be ashamed of themselves. It just looks sad the moment it's built, okay? This targets young urban professional couples. This, I don't even know who designs this. I mean, it can't be an architect, because if I had to draw a house, like if I was 10 and you asked me to draw a house, that's what I would draw. I'll draw a house, a little window, a little door. It's crazy, guys. If you're a builder or a developer or an architect listening to this YouTube video, stop building this shit. You're destroying Melbourne. Pay the architect the money and get a good design. Get something like this. Add to Melbourne, not take away from it. When I drive through Dandenong and Clayton, it's littered with this rubbish. And it looks sad. There's no capital growth. And then people wonder, why isn't there capital growth in Clayton? Well, there's nothing in Clayton, first of all. Second, apart from Monash campus, which doesn't add value to anything, okay, there's no correlation between Monash University, any university campus, and capital growth, okay? I would never let lease to a student because it will destroy the property. And Clayton is just filled with these cheap builds because the people are too tired to pay the right money and build a proper, you know, architectural design property. Anyway, number 10, buy properties that give you the maximum depreciation benefits, so brand new off the plane, because you get your depreciation on the building, 2.5% over 40 years, and depreciation on fixtures and fittings, which means you're getting money back from the ATO. It's cheaper for you to hold on to the property. That's the key. If you buy an older property from the 70s, you've got no depreciation on the building, no depreciation on fixtures and fittings, maintenance costs, and low rental yield. So you want to make sure that you, when you're building a property portfolio, guys, your holding costs are kept to a bare minimum. because you want to make sure that the properties are cash flow neutral or positive. And I'm actually going to do a video just purely on capital growth of brand new properties versus all the properties in terms of cash flow analysis and financial analysis, and you'll be blown away. So these are areas in Melbourne which have the highest capital growth over the last 10 years to 2017, which was the peak of the last property cycle. And you can see there, Mount Albert, 11.8%, Bulwer North, 11.4%, Biddle Park, 11%. These are double-digit growth. Mount Albert North, Ashburton, Bulwer, Glenmaverick, Doncaster, Mount Waverley, St Kilda West, Box Hill South, Dipindi, Camberwell, Blackburn, Surrey Hills, Box Hill North, McKinnon, Burwood East, Canterbury, Ashwood. These are the lowest capital growth suburbs. Based on those 10 criteria that I've showed you, Melton, number one, the lowest income per household. It's $437 or $447 per week. You know, you've got Officer, you've got Williams Landing. This is the growth, 2.5% per year in Melton. I mean, this is all below inflation, guys. You've got Williams Landing there, 3.2%. Like, yeah, people, like, I keep hearing about Williams Landing. Like, Toorak people are going to sell up and move to Williams Landing. No one cares about Williams Landing. You know, people can talk about it. It's like, what are you talking about? I don't know. I don't think people drive around Melbourne very well. Just like, take a drive around suburbs and have a look at the compositional suburbs that are good and bad. South Morang, Trigonina. It's not Trigonina. People keep mispronouncing it. It's an Aboriginal name of a group that used to own that land. It's Trigonina. Point Cook, Druin, St Albans and Tarnit, all below inflation, guys. So now, if you target a four-bedroom house with four bathrooms in Point Cook, in an okay part of Point Cook, you would just get inflation or 1% above inflation. So remember, inflation actually creates pressure on property prices. So you won't go backwards because it's still going up. That's why people actually tell me these stories. I bought for 400, now it's worth 700. I know, but there's other properties that went from 500 to 1.5 million. So $1 million they've gone up in value. You know, I bought a property in Vermont in 2008 for $650,000. I just had it valued for 1.89 million. So I made $1.2 million on just a normal house in an average suburb, you know. So these stories that people tell me, I always get these emails from people. And remember, we're talking about making money here, guys. There's nothing personal here. It's just about identifying opportunity costs. So what factors really determine property prices? It's location, location, location doesn't do it. It's high capital growth is determined by scarcity, high demand by the right income demographic. So scarcity meaning you can't produce stock. There's a limited finite stock. High demand by the right demographics. Now, why would they have high demand? Because of those 10 factors that I've just mentioned. Schools, safety, cafes, restaurants, proximity to the city, water, walk school, all that kind of stuff. So you've got to find those suburbs that have those key ingredients and then they've got the potential to gentrify. Crime is an issue as well in Melbourne. You can see there, these are the growth corridors in Melbourne, the dark patches. This is the crime in Melbourne and you can see there, so St Albans is the homicide suburb of Melbourne in terms of crime. You can see the red patches represent murders. So you can see the correlation between new house and land estates and crime is extreme. Lower income demographics, lower money, kids are on the street at night, roaming around, causing havoc. I mean, all these home invasions and all these carjackings, I mean, where's the father? I mean, this is the problem. It's not the problem. The problem is the parents is the problem. These kids are just, I mean, my parents would beat the shit out of me if I was 12 and I would leave the house. Forget about leaving after 10 o'clock. It just wouldn't happen. Like, how are these kids out at 3 in the morning and they're 12 and 13? Where are the parents? It's the parents' fault, not society's fault. And it's not the kids' fault either. My question is, where are the parents? So why I'm showing you this is not to do commentary on the problems we're experiencing in society. Remember, this is all about making money. Because these are high crime areas, wealthy people will never live there, full stop. They want to get away from these areas. Why? Because they can, and they can buy anywhere they like, which is one of the secrets and the key ingredients that must be there for gentrification to occur. right? And obviously, there's six. These are the six reasons why there are issues with new house and land packages. Number one is you got a low socioeconomic demographic. You've got issues associated with isolation, lack of community, because people turn around. Turnover is very high in property sales. People usually come home, drive into their property, and they never leave. So they drive in into the garage at 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock when they get home, and they come out the next day in the morning to go back to work, and they just sit at home, watch Netflix. Where people in areas like Elwood go out and they go for a walk, they go to cafes, they meet their friends. That's the main difference between house and land estates and established blue-chip trendy suburbs. So people with money want to be that person in Elwood where they can go for a walk at night, go to the gym, meet their friends, go for a coffee, just in front of their property, not to drive anywhere. Walking distance, that's the key. Lack of government planning and spending. We talked about in Melbourne, there's always the issue with Monash highways and the tunnel and all these, and I don't want to get into the challenges that the West has with infrastructure and everything. We know it's there. It's going to be addressed eventually. When? No one knows. And plus, we've got 400,000 migrants coming in, a lot of them will be buying in the house and land estates because of affordability. So good luck with getting that balancing act together. It's just not going to happen. Lack of shopping style infrastructure. The shopping centres are dysfunctional in these newer states. The best shopping strips are Centre Road, like for example in Melbourne or Sydney Road, Brunswick. We have kilometres of walk-up shops. That's what people want to pay a premium for. You know, these little shopping centres where you have 60 shops and you've got this massive car park and people are just angry just getting in there. You're already angry because you can never park. They're completely dysfunctional. They don't add value to the community at all. I don't even know who designs this rubbish. I mean, we have some of the worst architecturally designed, from a planning perspective, new suburbs that I've ever seen in any country. I mean, it's just rubbish being built and it's dysfunctional. America knows how to build estates. Europeans know how to build estates. Australians just keep building the same houses over and over. Four bedders, just thousands of them. Let's roll them out. And they become dysfunctional suburbs and the ghettos of tomorrow. Access to medical facilities and hospitals. If you're living in Point Cook or South Morang, the only hospital, if your child gets sick, seriously, you've got to go back to the city to the Royal Children's Hospital because the medical clinics in your suburb are dysfunctional. They're too small. They haven't got the equipment or the hours that they operate in. So the reality is that there's no hospitals there. And this is another key with gentrification. People are aware of this fact that there is this inadequate access to medicals, facilities and hospitals in the north and the west. And that's why those areas have a lesser chance of going through true gentrification compared to the southeast and the bayside areas. And obviously high risk of unemployment. The red patches represent the highest risk of unemployment. Surprise, surprise, new house and land estates and the fringes, right? So Tregennina, Tarnit, you've got South Morang and beyond, Barrack and Pakenham. And as a result, you have high record mortgage stress in these suburbs. One of the biggest things that people are not aware of is the amount of blocks that are available in these suburbs, which comes back to scarcity. This is publicly accessible information, and you can check this out for yourself, guys, because most of these companies are listed on the Australian Stock Exchange. So if we look at Pete, for example, one of the biggest landholders, has 444,000 blocks of land available, which is 17 years of supply. So there's about, at the moment, 11 years of supply, about 250,000 blocks that can be released in new house and land estates around the country, which is huge. So if you look at, and this is not even mentioning the farms that are optioned, and there's the joint ventures that are already there in place with these developers, these actual blocks to be ready to be released. So you can never have scarcity in new house or land estates, which is why they underperform. Can you imagine, like, forget about 17,000 blocks. Can you imagine Mervac, 26,000 blocks? Like, how many properties will be on the sale in St Kilda, where our office is, in a year? For houses. I mean, you're looking at 4 to 10 per week. So maybe 500, 400. Like, to get to 10,000, you have to wait a decade to get to that number. So the scarcity in St Kilda is much greater than a lot of these suburbs because there's simply not enough houses turning over and creating that supply. So Melbourne's richest and poorest suburbs is what we're interested in. So we want to have a suburb where this is what's happening now and this is the future. And you want to get in at this level here. That's the key. You don't want to get in at this level because then the money has been made. This is the level you want to get into. These are the most advantaged suburbs in Melbourne, which means this is government census. This is from the Australian Bureau of Statistics, which means advantage means people pay a premium to be there. East Melbourne, Glen Iris, Surrey Hills, Toorak, Brighton, Ivanhoe East, Surrey, South Yarra, Camberwell, Balmorris, Albert Park. Once again, if you just build your portfolio using these areas, you're set. These are the most disadvantaged suburbs in Melbourne. Broadmeadows is number one. Corio. Corio just won the most disadvantaged postcode in Victoria just last week. Campbellfield, Morwell, Breeside, Doveton, Meadow Heights, and just goes on, and St. Albans. And South and North, there's very big difference between St. Albans South and North. No, there isn't. There's nothing. It's the same. It's bad. It's bad. And then once again, we go to income. So individual incomes, you can see there's a high concentration of high income earners here because they can live anywhere they like. And obviously you've got the eastern suburbs like Eltham and, you know, Park Orchards and Donvale, but really it's just all here. And yeah, you have Yarraville. Essendon is a very wealthy area, and there's a couple of suburbs around Essendon. Mini Ponds, very good. So you want to identify the Yarraville of 20 years ago. So Yarraville is another example of gentrification. It's still going through gentrification. And now it's really going. So it went through rejuvenation initially and then gentrification. And it's becoming one of the trendiest, coolest suburbs in Melbourne for bars, pubs, cafes, restaurants, proximity to city. It's all there. So once again, we're looking at which one. So Richmond, for example, as we mentioned, income per week, 1,500. Now, the best properties to target for gentrification is Heidelberg Heights and Heidelberg West. And that's my number one target. And look at Heidelberg West, $450 per week per person in 2011, $782 in 21. And I think that figure will go to $1,200 very quickly as more wealthy people move in and those weatherboard and those housing commission units are getting ripped up, redeveloped as well. Now, by the way, before we get into the number one best suburb for gentrification, I want to stress the point. If you have a choice between buying a normal suburb that's high performing versus gentrification, you're better off just going for a normal suburb because nothing has to happen there. It's already happening. So gentrification suburbs are a risk because what if it doesn't happen? Or what if it doesn't happen to the same extent that everyone thought it was going to happen? Or, you know, what if it takes too long? The opportunity cost of not having happened sooner, which means you can't get more properties sooner. So this is the thing. It's a bit like mining towns. You hear these stories, you know, Karratha, South Hedland, Port Hedland, and look what happened there. It went backwards to virtually nothing. I remember Karratha was selling for $1.5 million. Now they're $600,000, you know. And there's all these stories about contracts with China and, you know, they've got forward contracts and options on this and options on that. And what if it doesn't eventuate? Or what if the mining company just simply changes its mind and then you're back to square one? So this is the problem, guys, with this gentrification as well. It's happened, it's a phenomenon that's occurring, people are making money out of it, but there's an element of risk as well. So if you have a choice, I recommend not going in there at all and going for normal suburbs. Now, if you want to take a bit of a gamble and you want to get in early, which I believe Heidelberg Heights and West have the best ingredients for getting in now, because only 30% of the suburb has been rejuvenated and redeveloped, the rest is going through and it's aggressively getting redeveloped. And so the money hasn't come in yet. It's going through rejuvenation and it's about to get ready for gentrification because the shops there are still average inside the suburb. There's no cafes, restaurants, or gyms or anything. You've got to go to Heidelberg proper, Eaglemont, Ivanhoe, Rosanna. There's nothing in Heidelberg Heights or West. It's still very rough. Anyway, going back to this, these are the best suburbs to invest in right now in Melbourne in May 2023 in terms of capital growth potential. Albert Park, Port Melbourne, St Kilda, especially St Kilda, guys, it's going to go through a roof right now in the next 6 months. Brighton, Bentley East, Elwood, Hampton, Sandringham, Blackrock, Balmorris. That's the upside, the highest high-end properties in the market. Entry level, Cheltenham, Hyatt, Mentone, Murrayallock, Aspendale, Edithvale, Chelsea, Bond Beach. Don't go to Seaford. Nothing's going to happen in Seaford. Chelsea Heights and Carrum. Stop at Carrum, okay? Seaford just never works. And Frankston, forget about Frankston, guys. I've been hearing this Frankston story since I was 18. I'm 46 now. Thank God I never bought anything in Frankston. You can't lose money in Frankston. It's just too far from the city, and there's a matching principle between supply and demand. Just do it. It does it 6%, 7%. It will never hit the double-digit growth that Cheltenham can hit, or Mentone, or Albert Park. It's just not going to happen. My eastern suburbs, so you have Mount Albert North, Kew, Canterbury, Camberwell, Surrey Hills, Hawthorne, Bulwyn North, Glen Waverley. That's for high-end properties. So you're looking at townhouses there between 1.4 to 2.2 million for three bedders. And they're cash flow neutral or positive, by the way. And I'm getting them all day long. A client's doing really well. Entry level Box Hill, especially Box Hill North, especially Box Hill around the hospital precinct, fantastic. Heidelberg Heights and West, Blackburn, Burwood, Burwood East, Mitcham, Bayswater, Doncaster, Doncaster East. So in terms of Heidelberg and Heidelberg Heights, in terms of entry level, as a suburb, it's still performing really well. 7.8% for newer properties going slightly higher. But like I said to you before, there's an element of risk because gentrification is just starting to happen there. Number one, obviously, is Heidelberg Heights and West. Now, this is Heidelberg and West is here. And this is Heidelberg Heights next door. Just near the Austin Hospital. This is what they look like. So the whole two suburbs were built up with these housing commission units that had asbestos in them. You can't renovate these. You can't do anything. Every government treated this like a hot potato. No one wanted to deal with this stuff, right? So you've got a person in there or a family living on a large block of land in these properties where there's black mold now occurring inside. They're terrible. And you can't renovate them. You can't do anything with them. So they sold all of them to the private sector. And now brand new builds are coming in, and those builds are selling for two bedders. You're looking at 750 to 850, and three bedders are going from the same price, 750 to 850, even 950. Now, last year they were $100,000 cheaper. 5 years ago, I was selling three bedders. Well, 2015, sorry, so 8 years ago, I was selling three bedders in the area for 475. Up to maybe 525, and two bedders were going for 400, 450. So they've actually gone up really well just in the last 8 years. Why Heidelberg? Well, number one is it's very green. It's close to the city. It's 12 km from the city, but the thing about it, it's a beautiful suburb aesthetically. Take out the properties, parks, very established trees. You haven't got trees in the west, which is the problem, because you've got salt water table just very close to the surface. So the moment you have a tree that sets its roots, it hits saltwater table, tree dies. So you will never have trees in Sanctuary Lakes and Point Cook to the same extent that you have in Heidelberg Heights and West. Heidelberg West, obviously, you have, it's a blue chip, leafy, surrounded suburb. So a lot of blue chip suburbs in every direction, which I'll cover in a second. Proximity to the city, it's 12 km, 13 km from the city. You got La Trobe University there, Austin Hospital, Northland Shopping Centre, massive amounts of cafes, restaurants surrounding the suburbs, not inside the suburbs, but near the suburbs. Low vacancy rate, capital growth is really good, excellent transport, and there's obviously a business park that the government's pumping money into. Now, the biggest thing about this suburb, guys, that's unique, is that the median price in Heidelberg Western Heights is $890,000, but as you get further from the city, it actually gets more expensive. So imagine the city's just there. You're getting further away, it gets more and more expensive. Rosanna's 1.2 and Viewbank's 1.21. Heidelberg is 1.4. Townhouse in Heidelberg is selling for 1.4 to 1.8, virtually $1 million, 700,000 to a million more than Heidelberg Western Heights. Eaglemont's 2.38. Ivanhoe, 1.68. Thornbury's 1.44. See, the difference between why this is such a good opportunity is because as you get further from the city, it gets more expensive. So in the other direction, look at Sunshine, for example, that's going through rejuvenation. And I'm a big fan of Sunshine as a suburb. Not that it's going through gentrification, it's going through rejuvenation. And I've sourced properties in Sunshine and Sunshine West, especially around the hospital precinct. But the moment you get beyond Sunshine, it starts getting worse and worse. Okay? It doesn't get better. It gets worse and worse and cheaper. And this is the unique anomaly with these suburbs that you're getting further away from the city and it gets more expensive. So you have the proximity, which is 12 km from the city, 1 kilometre from a Trobe University campus. You get all the lecturers and thousands of tutors that can potentially lease your property, and also 850 metres from the Austin Hospital. Now, I want to be clear with these guys. There is no correlation in terms of capital growth between any university campus and capital growth. Zero. So Monash Clayton is the biggest campus. Clayton, average suburb, average capital growth. What it does do, it drains the rental market because students obviously don't get mortgages, they have to rent, but they don't add value in terms of capital growth. Hospitals do. Hospitals add massive value to properties. So the Austin Hospital is 850 metres away from these suburbs. They have 9,000 employees and they're all nurses, doctors and medical allied. They have a huge impact on capital growth, massive, okay? Obviously, the other thing is you have dysfunctional shopping centres in your estates where you have these established shopping centres in the eastern suburbs like Northland, you know, Knox, all these kind of shopping centres, which is important. But more importantly, what people really want is these kilometres of cafes and restaurants where you can walk down, park your car, meet your friends for breakfast, lunch, dinner, go to a pub, go to a bar, go to a nightclub. There's only very few streets like that in Melbourne where you can do all those things and then walk back home. And that's what people pay a premium for, and that's what these suburbs have surrounding them. Really good food, really good restaurants. You're tapping into really good shopping, really good transport. And probably the best schools in Melbourne are in the eastern suburbs as well. Vacancy rate 0.62% for Heidelberg West, Heidelberg Heights 1.34%. And 41% rent in Heidelberg Heights, in West 54% rent. Transport, 2 kilometres from the Rosanna train station, Heidelberg train station, 4 kilometres, and 4 kilometres from McLeod train station. So very good trains. Bus, no one cares about buses, guys. There's no correlation between capital growth and buses. You can change a bus route, it's not important. Business parks are very important. In fact, they're spending billions of dollars on these incubation hubs for new startups. So this is a business centre where you have 4,500 employees, 600 businesses plus, from startups and hot desks up to boardrooms and, you know, companies with 50 employees. So these are the kind of properties that I'm sourcing now in Heidelberg Heights and West, just to give you a bit of price point idea. This property here is in Lay Street in Heidelberg West. So I'm focusing purely on 3-bedroom, double lock-up garage, and 2.5 bathrooms. Here's an example for $849,000. And that property will be completed in December. Here's another one, another example. So you have a double lock-up garage, bedroom downstairs with an ensuite, study nook, laundry as well underneath the stairs, storage. Then upstairs you have 2 bedrooms, built-in robes, common ensuite. Then you've got a living, dining, and a kitchen area and the balcony. Perfect property, only one of four. $850,000. Now, 12 months ago, these were $750,000. 3 years ago, there were $675,000. So already they're going up like this because construction materials are going up and land's going up in the area, far beyond what the market's doing. So very good layout, low maintenance, and you're kind of targeting young professional couples with no children, doctors, medical allied. That's who you're targeting in this particular example. So once again, work, home, and school. So remember, imagine you live in Heidelberg West, you go to work at the Austin Hospital as a nurse, your kids go to Heidelberg Secondary College, 5-10 minute drive each way, and you're 12 k's from the city. You think the area is going to go up in value? Absolutely it's going to go up in value. And that's why the money's moving into those suburbs. I can see it every day that I'm driving through. More houses are coming in, European cars, entry-level Mercedes, BMW, Audis. You can just see the money coming in every week. There's more and more. So the good thing about this, like, you have, number one, you got all the schools, okay? Number two, you got the childcare facilities. One of the biggest problems and challenges with new estates is there's no childcare facilities because we call new estates on the fringes of Melbourne nappy valleys because there's nappies in the rubbish bins are filled with nappies, right? So there's a disproportionate amount of new babies and kids, but there's no childcare facilities. Where 12 k's from the city, you have a huge amount of childcare facilities. Shops galore from your walk-up Bell Street malls up to your, you know, Northland Shopping Centre, which is your traditional large shopping centre. You've got the health facilities, medical clinics, Austin Hospital. You've got the Heidelberg Hospital. So you've got all these different, Cabrini Private as well. So within 1 kilometre, you've got like 10 different hospitals you can access, which is huge. And once again, one of the challenges with the fringe suburbs, whether you've got north or west, is there's no real hospitals. You've got to go back to city. And transport. You know, you have all these train stations within 3 km of the suburb. So it ticks all the boxes, and that's why the money's moving in. The capital growth has been, for Heidelberg West, 23% in 3 years, 13.66 for 5, for 10 years, 7.44. See, this is important. Why is it 7.44? Because this has just started now in the last few years. That's why it's still low overall over 10 years, because if this was high, it means the ship has sailed, guys. If this was 13 or 15, it means that you've missed the boat you're buying at the peak. So you're getting in at the very bottom. Only 30% by guesstimation, just by physically driving through the streets of Heidelberg Heights and West, I think 30% of properties are redeveloped, 70% are still the original housing commission units that have to be redeveloped. So you're getting in at the early days where the money is. And eventually these areas will be very expensive, guys. It will be like Eaglemont, Ivanhoe, you know, Rosanna. It will be that level. Here's another example. 849,000, three-bedroom, double lock-up garage, two bathrooms. 940 for three-bedrooms. See, the new ones that are coming out, by the way, are already 940. And it's already creeping up to the $1 million mark. So, I mean, this was 650 just 3 years ago. You know, 4 years ago. I mean, it's crazy. It's 100,000 every year, guys. How long would it take you to save 100 grand at work? Just think about it. You're signing just a bunch of papers here, a contract of sale. You're sitting on this property making 100 grand a year. And it's cash flow positive or neutral. Here's another one, 835,000, which is two bedroom plus study, 2.5 bathrooms, single car garage. So there's different configuration there. Here's another one for 899. Which is three bedroom, 2.5 bathroom, and you have a tandem car park, carport here. Here's another one, which is 830, three bedroom, double lock-up garage, and or carport, and then you have two bathrooms. Here's another one for 840, two plus study, 2.5 bathrooms. So that means it's two en suites plus a toilet for the guests, and the single car garage lockable. Here's another one, 795, 2x2x1. So if you're interested in hearing more about these properties, and I'm sourcing a lot of properties now in Heidelberg Heights and West, but I'm running out of properties as well because they are selling quickly. And there's only so many developers that operate in the area. Plus, the council is super slow in the area. It takes months and months and months to sit there to get these things approved. So there's a finite amount of stock coming up as well. And if it is coming up, it's coming up at a premium because every day that you wait, especially in these two suburbs, you're paying a premium above market. But if you are interested, simply just email me, conrad@investorsprime.com.au, or give me a call and I'm happy to email you what I have, what's coming up, and I'm happy to have a session with you and go through all the options with you. Hope you enjoy this video, guys. If you're interested in learning more, by the way, I am running live events again. So I'm running my two-day events called the Real Estate Investing Fast Track Weekends. They're back in Melbourne. They're here in St Kilda in my office. They do book out very quickly. So if you're interested in learning about that, jump onto realestatefasttrack.com.au and book yourself in. Tickets are $47, plus you get a hard copy of my book, Australian Real Estate Investing Made Simple. For those of you who have 5 properties already or more and you want to get to 10, 15, but you're maxed out or you want to go to the next level, I encourage you guys to buy yourself and access the Property Portfolio Accelerator Summit 2022 online video course. This is 30 hours of content, and this is where you're going to be learning from these 10 speakers about how to build and structure a large property portfolio. So this is for people that, the two-day event is for people that have 0 to 5 properties. 5 to 10, this is for you guys. It's a 4-day boot camp that you can watch and dissect and digest at your leisure from your home, on the comfort of your own home, rather than spending 4 days locked up with a bunch of strangers in a room. Plus, you get a big 560-page manual. So all that information there is available at your fingertips, and that's $997. And just jump onto propertyriches.com.au/PPAS2022. Also, if you want to have a consultation with me, and where I can determine where you are, where you want, and you tell me where you want to be, I can give you some feedback. I'm offering a 60-minute strategy session for anyone who wants to build a large property portfolio purely by investing in Melbourne blue chip suburbs through buy and hold, never sell investment strategy, which is what I teach. This is where we take an idea and into a plan and translate it into an action. And the most important thing, guys, if you don't plan, you plan to fail. If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. So you want to make sure you have a written plan, and you want to make sure you've got access to these consultants that can implement what you want to do. Otherwise, you're going to be spending your life doing this, which is wasting a lot of time. We could be doing this, fast-tracking your results by having a clear, concise plan, a vision, an action plan, and the consultants that can put it all into reality for you. So these sessions are one-hour sessions on Zoom where you walk away with a real blueprint. The minimum requirement is you need to at least have a serviceability to buy a $700,000 property. I just don't source anything under $700,000 at the moment. There are a couple of projects that I have in Mornington that are $685,000, but $700,000 is the minimum. You've got to have an income as a single person of $95,000 and access to $112,000 in equity. You can actually settle a property. And a couple, you need to be on $140,000 plus $112,000 in equity, and then you can borrow $700,000 based on current interest rates. So if you are, if you do qualify, just send me an email that you're interested in having a session with myself. If you've been to a live event, just send me the form and fill that out. Otherwise, conrad@investorsprime.com.au, and I hope to meet you in person. That's it for me, guys. Thank you very much for listening to this video today. This is Konrad Bobilak, and I hope to see you at my live event in the future. Take care.